next door into Italian Market, right down the street. I was born and raised in Culver City. The only candidate really that was born in the city and have been here ever since. My civic engagement so far has, I'm on the board of directors of the Upper Bound House, YMCA, the Exchange Club, and the Chamber. I believe that Culver City really is a pivotal turning point in development, in business sense, and we really need to proceed and really create a strong business environment, a community that can support the quality of life that we've all been accustomed to here in Culver City. I love this city. I love everything about it, and I want to try to nurture that feeling of hometown sort of atmosphere and continue it forward into the next generation. Thank you.
Daniel Lee.
Good morning, and just in case I'm a little flagging, I just want to say I am not a morning person. I know a lot of business-minded people are. I am not. I just want to be honest about that. Hopefully my energy will rise exponentially as we go on. But my name is Daniel Lee. I'm running for City Council in Culver City. I've been a resident here for the last 15 years. For the last 7 years, I've served on the Martin Luther King Jr. Celebration Committee. I've been a regular volunteer at El Rincon Elementary through the Young Storytellers Program. I've participated in community groups like the Sierra Club's Clean Break Committee, the Culver City Community Coalition, and the Culver City Action Network. My background, I'm a Bruin and I'm a Trojan. I went to USC for undergrad for film school. I got my MSW from UCLA. I'm also a veteran, but of the Air Force and Air National Guard. My specialty was SATCOM, WIPAN, telemetry and space systems. I was a staff sergeant. I was not an officer. But I think my experience there actually gave me a lot of insight in terms of working with others. I was in charge of teaching CPR and combat first aid, which we called self-aid buddy care. My opinions around business in Culver City basically focus on, to some degree, the general plan, but our plan for our requirements for businesses for the next 20 or 30 years, are those going to include sustainability? Are they going to include significant community benefit? Are there going to be public-private partnerships? And more specifically, is there going to be programming in our individual business districts that connects not only stakeholders or people who would come into Culver City to spend money, but the people who already live here and have lived here for decades to the businesses and make them want to come back to them on a regular basis because they truly feel that they are part of the community. Thank you.
Alex Fish.
Morning, Chamber. My name is Alex Fish. I am the city's the chair of the city's Committee on Homelessness, and I've been on that committee for about 3 years. We're a very active committee, and we've taken the county's 47 strategies on preventing and combating homelessness, looked at what role cities could play, and helped the city begin to develop programs to get people off the streets and keep them in their homes. I am a Deputy Attorney General for the state of California. I work in natural resources, primarily protecting clean air, clean water, forests, and that sort of thing, endangered species. I've personally worked on endangered species cases, but that's what we do. I'm a graduate of UC Berkeley. I graduated with honors in my major of, brace yourselves, political economy of industrial societies. just poli-sci and econ, but we got to sort of, it was a major where we could design our own emphasis, and I focused on Western cities, developed country cities, both the intangible qualities that make cities culturally interesting and exciting and productive, but also the nuts and bolts of how cities tick. I'm a graduate of UCLA School of Law, where I graduated in the top 10 of my class. I clerked for a Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals judge afterwards, then worked in a corporate law firm, was a partner. While I was a partner, helped found a nonprofit organization that is currently operating 45 academic field schools in 22 countries around the world. While I was also working in private practice, I received a commendation from the County of Los Angeles for pro bono service, in which for helping Dee Dee Hirsch acquire a mental health facility without interruption. Dee Dee Hirsch added a location without denying a single night of care to the patients at that facility. then I came to work for the state and became much more active locally. I've been a homeowner for 13 years here in Culver City. I have two kids in Culver City schools, and I absolutely love it here. And I will die in this city. Great to meet you all. Hopefully far in the future. And let's talk about traffic and parking now. Sales tax.
Albert, could you put the other microphone on your stand? Like, give us some feedback. All right. The first question of the day goes to Marcus Tiggs. With almost 30% of the city's budget coming from sales tax revenue, what will you do to sustain and or increase that source?
With that question, I'll start off by saying that we need to cultivate, mentor, love the existing businesses that we have in our city. Because sometimes we have a tendency to say, well, let's look for new businesses, new sources of revenue. That's fantastic. We have to do that. But in addition, we need to still give a lot of love to the existing businesses. And when you go to our downtown Culver City, sometimes it's striking when there is a business open one day, and then that business closes 8 months later. Or, you know, when you have that type of situation, we have to internally ask ourselves, what is going on? I think there's a role for government, and there's a role for the chamber. Because it could be high rents, it could be saturation of types of businesses within our city. But we also need to be forward looking. We need to look for streams of additional revenue, whether it is taxing ride sharing companies, whether it's TOT taxes. We need to continue forward looking, because that general fund is what drives our city and what keeps the quality of life that we have here.
I think we really need to nurture the businesses that we have here in the city and really find out what they need to thrive and what we can do as a city to help them. Also bringing in new businesses into the city, we really need to create a balance of what businesses we want in the city, what's good for the area and what's not. I think only through that, as we work with the chamber and with the city, to really listen to the needs of the business owners, see what they really need to thrive. And you know, a good thriving business economy means a good thriving city. Pays for the services that we need, and I think it's really vitally important.
Daniel Lee.
In terms of the question you asked, I think in regards to sales tax, we need to talk about Measure Y and whether or not we're going to extend it, or whether or not that extension would both benefit the budget of the city and whether or not it would have a harmful impact on the businesses that are currently operating in the city. If we don't extend Measure Y, then the city will be at a deficit, which would not be a good thing for the city or the businesses in general. But I think sort of in a broader context, we need to talk about, as I mentioned before, and I think I'll probably bring up again, what type of programming or branding that we could do to concentrate the traffic that's already going to businesses in Culver City. Is there some phrase that we can come up that could make Culver City a destination and sort of make it concrete in the minds of the people of Southern California that this is the destination, this is what I do in Culver City, and this is why I come back so much? I think in terms of sales tax revenue, which is your real question, how to increase it means how do we increase business for the businesses that are already here, and how do we make sure that the new businesses that move in, particularly in some of these locations with high turnover, are actually successful? What can the city do to support them? Because if the city supports them, then they stay longer and we get more tax revenue. But I think it's a combination of maintaining the tax revenue that we already get from Measure Y, but also making sure that the new businesses that come in are supported to a degree that they actually have a lifetime, that they are here for a generation and not just 6 months.
Alex Fish.
I think that for the first 100 years of the city, the initial vision of Harry Culver was basically right, and that is the correct path forward. Having a mix of industry and retail and residence is what makes one of the great things about the city. It makes it interesting, makes it dynamic, it makes it resilient. And those are all good qualities in a city. Especially, it's unique for a city this size. I have friends who are council members in other, smaller Los Angeles county cities, and they don't have the same mix that we have. So sales tax is a huge component, of course, for a variety of reasons, and it's really critical to cultivate it, but that really means cultivating the whole mix of the city. I increasingly hear more and more from people asking about support for startups. I don't know if you've traditionally done that. At least we're not connecting with people who are really interested in beginning businesses, non-traditional businesses in the city. And I see that. I see the change, both in the creative economy and in the mix. We're accommodating well. There's a lot of opportunity, though, I think, in terms of reaching out and connecting with people. For example, when I moved in, the place behind my house had clearly been some sort of metal casting manufacturing facility. And when I moved in, it was an abandoned warehouse. And now it's full of some sort of internet company that I have no idea what they do. But they feed the local restaurants, and they shop at Lundin's. And those are the types of activities that really enrich the city, both our civic life of seeing people walking out and about from the day jobs and providing revenue to the city. So yes, we need to make Culver City a destination. And I think a big part of that is really focusing on the quality of life for residents, the business climate for you guys, and making sure that the infrastructure exists and that people are able to get to businesses, and also supporting the industry that's here during the day.
Thank you. Follow-up question for Daniel Lee. You mentioned Measure Y. Have we used those funds appropriately in the city? And at this point, should we extend Measure Y?
Well, I think on the first part, the extension of Measure Y should be up to the residents of Culver City. I think we should either through a process of community forums or through a ballot measure let the residents decide whether or not Measure Y is extended. I think in terms of the use of the Measure Y funds, there's no doubt that Culver City and the businesses of Culver City are on a better footing because of the funds that Measure Y gave the city during the financial crash. That is without dispute. So I think the funds were used appropriately. And I think since things like financial crashes are cyclical, that's why we should take a very long, hard look about whether or not we let that sunset permanently, because financial crashes happen every 7 to 10 years. And if they happen again, those funds will come in handy again.
Again, are you for or against the extension of Measure Y?
I'm for. I thought that was clear.
No, thank you. Anybody else have a thought on Measure Y? Alex?
Measure Y is a huge part of the city's budget. I forget, I think it's $9 million. It's in that area, but obviously it was critical during the crash, and I think while you can retrospectively or even contemporaneously critique any given expenditure of municipal funds, during the time since we enacted it to today, we've seen the public safety portion of our general fund budget go up 10 points, and that's a function of the pension crisis, which I'm sure we'll talk about soon. And so I think it's a little unfair to. While Measure Y was temporary, it has fulfilled a very important role in cushioning, giving us some time to transition into planning for the full brunt of the pension wave. So I would support an extension of Measure Y. It definitely has to go to voters, at least at least by 2022. But I recognize that it's a significant burden. I recognize that we have one of the highest sales taxes in the state.
Al Barbera.
I'm definitely in support of extending or not letting Metro Y sunset. I believe that if we do, the city would be facing bankruptcy, actually. We're looking good right now financially, but a lot of the money that we have is one-time money. Once the development starts, drying up and we get these fees that are coming in, the one-time money fees, we're going to be really in bad shape. So I think we really need to push that Measure Y does not sunset, put it on the ballots, and we really definitely need to keep it on the books, and really create a reserve that we can bank on for a rainy day, because a rainy day is coming. We have a structural deficit and unfunded pension fund that we really need to think about, and we really need to conserve the money and keep it for the rainy day.
Marcus Tiggs.
I know about economic cycles. I'm a bankruptcy lawyer. I've been doing that for a long, long time. Let's keep in mind, why did Measure Y come about? Measure Y came about because we lost some money from the redevelopment agencies. That $9 million, and that's an accurate number, Alex, that $9 million is part of our general fund. If we didn't have the $9 million, the level of services would be degraded. There's just no doubt about it. Now, at the same token, I think Measure Y, we need to try to convince the voters to extend it, but we need to do more than talk. This 2020 is gonna be around the corner. We need to educate the public and let them know and not make assumptions that everyone in Culver City is gonna say, yeah, I'm gonna do it. We need to explain to the voters that this is what we've done to increase revenue in our city. This is what we've done to reduce costs where we can, and this is why we need to extend Measure Y. We need to explain, instead of just saying, your house is gonna burn down if you don't extend it, the police aren't gonna come to your house, it's gonna take them 20 minutes, we need to be more transparent with it.
Thank you, gentlemen. The second question to Al Rivera. What is your opinion of the fiscal well-being of the city? What improvements are necessary, if any, and your thought of the existing pitfalls or ticking time bombs that we have, how would we address them?
Any part of the question?
Well, fiscal well-being being of the city.
In talking to Mr. Muir, right now the city is looking good. Fiscally, financially we are, but like I said, that's one-time money that we're looking at. Once that one-time money dries up, we're gonna be really, really struggling. So I think it's really imperative to talk with the businesses right now that are bringing in the most sales tax, trying to really enhance the services or the quality of businesses that we bring into the city. Pitfall-wise, if we do let Measure Y sunset, we're really looking at some major problems with the city. I think we really need to be active in the businesses that are there, see what their needs are, see what we as a city can do to help them out, help their businesses grow, but attracting businesses to the city that would be beneficial to the city. It's all about balance. You know, we can't just bring in businesses to max out our money and then leave out. We really need to look at a good balance of what the city brings into what the business brings into the city and what the city can really use out of that business.
Daniel Lee. Same question.
So the financial health of the city is good at the present moment, but I would agree with Albert in terms of the potential pitfalls that we're facing. One, there's a sunset of Measure Y, but two, as has been brought up at many forums and city council, in the context of both of those, one, we need to see if we can educate and extend Measure Y after a consultation with the residents. But two, we need to also look for additional sources of revenue. And I think there are a number of different ways that we can do this. We're going through a general plan process in the next few months. One of the things that we can do in terms of the context of the general plan and the sustainability plan more broadly, that more specifically addresses sustainability, is if we have a sustainability plan, for instance, there are different types of funds that we can apply for because we have a sustainability plan that could be, and if we successfully got that money, we could use that to pay for services and things that we're committed to, like the Clean Water Project in relation to the Bayona Creek, and possibly some of that money could be freed up to pay for other services in terms of the general fund. Additionally, And I've mentioned this before, we need to look to the Culver City School Board and their use of solar panels on their school buildings and the very swift return that they've seen on that. If we did the same thing with Culver City government buildings, we might also see a return, and we might be able to count on that as a consistent source of revenue. I realize that would not be a large source of revenue, but I think in the context of the challenges that we face, we need to look beyond simply sales taxes to diverse sources of revenue, and wherever they may come from, either public or private, and make sure that us as a city, we have everything in place in terms of a sustainability plan, climate resilience plan, an updated general plan, so that we can apply for those funds, that so that our general budget does not have to be on the hook, so that possibly we can get those items paid for by an outside source.
As it relates to the solar panels, are the same grants still available that the school district was available to get when they put their solar panels in?
I'm not certain if the same grants are available, but there are a number of different types of grants, and then there are a lot of public-private partnerships where, for instance, a private solar company will pay for the majority of the infrastructure of both installing the solar panels and ultimately owning them, and do a profit share, a profit share arrangement, so that the city would get some benefit, and the private company would get some benefit, but that's not the only model.
Thank you. Alex Fitch.
I'm not going to distinguish between pitfalls and time bombs. I'll lump them together, pitfalls and time bombs. The fiscal health of the city is good right now. There's a mid-year report on Monday's agenda that is pretty good. It's better than expected. We've had better revenues than expected, and it is largely one-time revenue sources and highly cyclical revenue sources, which a lot of our revenue sources are highly cyclical. Sales tax is highly cyclical. The money from transfers is highly cyclical. Permit fees are highly cyclical. So that's something we need to begin to prepare for and plan for. Long term, we've got one thing that people haven't really talked about much is that there's a decline in certain types of utility user fees, in particular telephone. So that's, it's $500,000 a year. It's not a huge amount, but that's it could be off on that, but it's directionally or order of magnitude, that's about right. It's just that, we've got these small changes in people's behavior that is changing our revenue mix. And then also the decline of certain types of retail. That could be a big issue. No one really knows which way it's gonna go. The formerly Westfield Mall seems healthy, but it's something that the city needs to be mindful of. So I think also additionally, there's the Clean Water Act compliance obligations, which nobody's been able to really estimate concretely, but it's been thrown out in the order of $100 million over a very short period of time. That one, I think actually Culver City has dodged the bullet mostly because that's an enforcement question. The issue is who is the Regional Water Board or the EPA gonna focus on? And a city that's enacted a tax, albeit not a comprehensive tax, to help to start address its Clean Water Act obligations is a less appealing enforcement target than a city that's not doing anything. Additionally, we can make ourselves look even better, I think, by moving quickly towards low impact development standards and ordinance and encouraging not just new developments, but also homes, other people with land for water infiltration to do things like build water retention on site, these things that can reduce stormwater, and so that we can say, look, we've got a model that does, you said that this would be 1 to 3% of our watershed management plan compliance obligations, but we're doing much better than that. We're retaining and cleaning a ton of water. So that's another opportunity. And of course, pensions. There's really nothing, this is a huge, it's a sort of a tidal wave because you can't stop these pensions from coming due. They're earned and under the California rule, the unique circumstances of California's pension system, they're inevitable, they're inexorable. We're gonna have to address these this increasing amount of CalPERS obligations. And we'll just have to scramble. We'll have to look at what our tax mix is, where the opportunities are, and hopefully we can take opportunities like Culver City Connect, the fiber line that's being built, and leverage that and to create and use that as a source of revenue as well.
Marcus Dix.
the fiscal well-being of the city, cautiously, it's looking good. And I say cautiously because as time goes on, there's going to be changes. I mean, it's not going to look as good. I hate to say that, but that's just how reality is. As far as time bombs, the underfunding of the pensions. A couple of city councils ago, they spent a lot of work, a lot of time, rolled up their sleeves, and worked out some new collective bargaining agreements with employee unions. Comparing the benefits that the new employees get versus the legacy employees, it's night and day. So that council was forward thinking. Doesn't help us exactly right now, but in the future, it will. What can we do right now? We need to think about, like other cities, stockpiling and putting some money away for this the underfunded pensions. At some point, it's going to hit us, just like it's going to hit other cities. So we need to seriously look at that and how much we want to put aside each year in a fund to deal with it and pay a little bit extra, because there is going to be a bill coming, and we want to be prepared when that bill comes. Clean Water Act compliance, that's a big one as well. Though there's a parcel tax that was approved by the voters, that's definitely helping us. We're a bit ahead. We're a bit ahead of the game compared to other cities, but we need to also keep our eyes on that. Measure Y, that's a huge one. That's been discussed. Measure Y, if that sunsets, I think we're going to be in a world of hurt. And we need to convince the voters, explain to the voters why it's important to extend Measure One. Additional sources of revenue. Let's talk. I want to talk about some things where we could have gotten some more revenue, but we've kind of been, it's been taking a long time to make decisions. Short-term rentals, TLT tax. Why has it taken 2+ years to come up with a regulation on that? Is it that complex? Is it more complex than cannabis? Cannabis, we can figure that out in 8 months. Cannabis tax, that's going to bring some extra money to us. I don't know how much, but it's definitely going to be some extra money. All this extra money, where is it going? It's going into our general fund. That keeps that quality of life that we all expect, you as business owners, we as well as residents. Rideshare. In the day when the city issued licenses to taxis, that's kind of gone. I remember like 3 years ago, we were talking about we're going to start looking at maybe levying some sort of taxes on ride sharing so we get our fair share of revenue from these ride sharing companies. They're using our roads. They're clogging up our streets. So these are like the low hanging fruit that I think we need to start looking at before or contemporaneous when we look at new income streams. Let's focus on income streams that are right in front of us and prioritize that and then move forward.
Thank you. Next question, speaking of traffic, all roads lead to Culver City. We're the spoke of the West Side. What solutions do you have for pass-through traffic that is not coming to or going from Culver City? Daniel Lee.
So yeah, this is a hard one. I think part of the solution, and as you said, all roads lead to Culver City, is to make that traffic stop in Culver City and buy some dinner, have a drink. I think for the last, I'd say 10 to 30 years, a lot of our traffic philosophy has been to get people through Culver City. But I think overall, from a policy perspective, we should be doing the opposite. We should be getting people to Culver City, and we should make Culver City a sort of unattractive as a through city. If anything, we should try to divert people to the main arterials and east-west corridors that we have, which basically include Venice, Jefferson, and the 10 freeway. I think from a personal perspective, we should try to dissuade people from using Washington. Cuts right through the heart of our city and a lot of our business centers. A part of doing that is making sure that we have the type of bicycle and pedestrian infrastructure that connects to the mass transit infrastructure that already intersects with Culver City. This includes the Culver City Metro Station downtown, and the West LA Transit Center at Fox Hills Mall. I think a combination of these things, focusing more on bringing people to Culver City than through, and actually, and I know a lot of people will be chagrined by this. I know a lot of people don't live in Culver City, but I think from a business perspective, if we really do focus on making Culver City even more of a destination than it's already has become in the last 15 years, then we can solve our traffic woes by having people say, oh, that place is too popular, I'm gonna go around.
Alex Fish.
Right, all the roads lead to Culver City, not through. We should focus, I think, on, in the near term, obviously, we should do the things that we're doing. We should continue implementing an automated traffic system, control system that's in the mid-year budget. It's a project that's ongoing. And this allows some improvement at the margins of traffic flow. So that's obviously you got to do the little things to make people's lives a little more livable. Long term is the much more interesting question, because we all know that there's only so much space. We're not going to bulldoze your businesses to increase the space of roads. We all know that that's a failed approach. The 405 is the classic example. We spent, I think at the end of the day after lawsuits, it was $1.5 billion, or maybe, I may be off by an order of magnitude. It was a huge amount of money for 9 lane miles, and ultimately traffic, the transit times over the same span took an additional minute. So you build capacity for cars, people drive, and you end up with more pollution, same congestion. Worse congestion, because then you're getting more cars on the same street. So long term, we need to transition to a world where a lot of our needs are met closer to where we are. We need to prioritize areas that are already walkable and make them even more walkable and expand beyond them so that people can stop, park their cars on the perimeter, and move around. We need to price parking appropriately so that there's always one or two spots on every block. So when you are driving to Culver City, you know you can leave your car in a lot if you're gonna stay for a while, or on the street if you're going for a short time, there'll always be a space. Then you know that you can actually walk and take care of a few things. So this is a long-term vision. In the general plan, we'll talk about it, we'll all come together, we'll talk about housing as well, because it fits right in with this. And ultimately, the idea is that you have to give people options besides driving, and that's a long-term project. It won't be easy, but you have to think in that way, I think.
Marcus Tiggs.
We're surrounded by LA. We have massive projects in LA that's going around us. So yeah, all roads lead to or through Culver City. That's accurate. But we're not going to stop this pass through traffic. It's here to stay. The issue in my mind is how do we keep that traffic moving as effective as possible? Adaptive traffic signals, which essentially is a smart traffic signal. There's sensors on the road. This traffic signal determines the movement of traffic and it adjusts accordingly. The ones we have now, which we have approximately 160, 170 control signals in our city, there might be a couple that are actually adaptive. How those signals work is they're kind of analog. A traffic engineer sets it up. He or she thinks, okay, this is the peak hours. We're gonna have it come on red, amber, green at certain time sequences. That kind of works. It works until a bus goes through there and it has priority, or a police car going on a call, or a fire truck going on a call, which gets priority. Then it messes up the sequence. Then it has to reset and go again. There's high tech stuff out there. There is Uber Movement, which gives real-time traffic data. There's low-tech stuff out there. I'm gonna keep mentioning it until I start seeing some traffic control officers out there in some of these congested intersections. What about having one or two on one of these intersections to move that traffic along in the meantime? It helps a lot. When that truck is stalled for whatever reason, or that motorist is doing something really stupid, it's kind of nice to have a traffic control officer saying, hey, get over there, move it. Transportation demand management programs. Other cities have them. We're kind of falling behind on that, though in certain large projects we require it. Why don't we make it mandatory for companies that over a certain number of employees? From there, we're going to have a better idea of how many of your employees are taking transit, how many of your employees are walking, how many of your employees are driving. Then there's incentives for them to use the metro. Last mile, first mile. That's a key component here. I live in Rancho Higuera. It's convenient for me to take the metro, but if I lived in Fox Hills, it's not convenient for me to take the metro. How do we get people from Fox Hills to that metro station? You know, microtransit possibly. Have some of these projects give us some real mitigation measures other than restriping, other than changing out a signal, other than saying I can't do anything, other than extending that turnpike. That's 20th century traffic engineering. We're in the 21st century, and we have to start looking outside of the box. And I refuse to believe we can't mitigate the traffic to the extent it's a little bit more livable.
Albert Vera.
Traffic is, it's a regional issue. We can't solve it in Culver City alone. Excuse me. Last traffic survey said that over 3 million cars pass through Culver City a day. Over 3 million cars, how can we control that? How can we stop that? We can't. It's a regional problem. We really need to reach out of Culver City, work with our surrounding cities, and come to get a roundtable meeting and come to a solution, something that would work. I believe mass transit is another means which we should be supporting, looking to mass transit where we can have a dedicated bus lane or a flex lane, something where we can move larger groups of people at a given time. And we have to be cautious about moving traffic through the city or limiting traffic through the city. As a business person, I know if I'm driving through the city and I can't get to a specific business, I'm not going to go. I'll go elsewhere. I'll go online. I'll do something else. So we really have to be mindful of what we do to traffic. And if we limit traffic too much, then we're going to really stifle a lot of the businesses. Instead, it's a regional problem. We need to think outside the box and try to figure out a way with our surrounding city, something that would work. Whether ride sharing, give businesses incentives for work at home days, something where we can start getting people out of their cars, using mass transit, using the bus system, using bike share, whatever it takes, but to limit traffic through the city, the cut through traffic, I fear it's almost impossible. It's something we really need to work regionally with our surrounding cities and come to a conclusion.
Thank you. Alex Fish, this is for you. Culver City is looking at affordable housing and housing affordability. Briefly, what are your views on zoning, rent control, affordable housing, and how these issues should be handled by the city?
How long do I get here?
About a minute and a half.
All right. As the chair on the city's committee on homelessness, I think about some of these issues a lot in that lens. And as a real geek for planning, I think about other parts of this question a lot. Because affordable housing is a loaded term. It really, I think of it as two sort of things, little A affordable housing and big A affordable housing. Big A affordable housing is sort of what people fear, the subsidized housing. We're long past the point of debating whether we should be building below market housing in our city. We need homes that are below market. And there's $2 million a year coming back to the city from the windup of redevelopment right now. We lost between $30 and $50 million, depending on who you ask, when redevelopment rolled up. That's for affordable housing. It's now coming back in drips and drabs of $2 million a year. We need to deploy that. And we need to, I think, look to the county for an upfront payment so that we can go out and make a big purchase of something that's already existing. Because if we try to build brand new units or we try to buy covenants at new construction, you're looking at $700,000 a unit, whereas if you're buying, say, an existing hotel or an old triplex and going out into the community and preserving what's already affordable as a market matter, you're talking more like $400,000, $450,000 a unit. So we should be thinking about it in that way. How do we leverage the $2 million as well as possible? We need an inclusionary zoning ordinance. That's the idea that once a development of homes is over a certain size, a certain portion needs to be provided below market. Obviously, that's a public benefit, and I think the community is at a point when we've got 57,000 homeless people, and we've got teachers with 90-minute one-way commutes in our schools, people understand that we need that big A affordable housing. So I think there's a buy-in for creating below market units in this way, considering a public benefit. So that's another opportunity. I think that should sort of be focused on workforce. Initially, I thought we should be focused on the least among us, providing a very, very low income, and certainly we need to do that somewhat. But you get more units from an inclusionary zoning ordinance when you have a lesser subsidy for each unit. So the need is so great at every level, we need to focus on that. The little A affordable housing is something we'll talk about, that's the market. And we'll talk about that in the general plan. We need to find a way equitably to preserve our neighborhoods and yet grow the city a little bit. So that, because obviously we can't change the regional market for housing, but we are going to lose local control if we don't start to take things seriously. There's a Senate bill right now that would take away local control in a way that's never been seen before in California. That will not be the last bill that's out there if cities don't start taking the obligation to house people near jobs that we're creating seriously. As for rent control, I think you should devote another 90 seconds to that.
Thank you for your response. Marcus Tiggs.
There's no doubt affordable housing, it's a crisis in our state. As most of you are aware, I think there was approximately 15 bills that became law this year that the governor signed off on dealing with affordable housing, whether it's for veterans, whether it's for certain infill developments, whether it's giving a bulk of money to encourage the building of affordable housing projects. On top of that, one of the bills actually, if you read it carefully, it looks like it takes away some control that the cities actually have in connection with where, if a developer wants to build an affordable housing project in the city, streamlining the permitting process, increasing the density a bit. The general plan update, the review that our city's gonna be going through is gonna be extremely critical, especially on the housing element. And I say this because we talk about affordable housing probably in almost every forum that we go to, but at the same token, when we look at, do you want an affordable housing complex, if you will, down the street from your house, we need to ask ourselves, do we really want one? I think it's good, I think it's healthy, but sometimes just talking about stuff, and then when it comes time to do things, it becomes very challenging. I have a personal experience in relation to this. When I was on the Planning Commission, entitlements were coming up for Upward Bound House taking over a motel, a dilapidated motel. Great organization of what they do, but some of the community members were adamantly against it. Even though there was probably 100 plus conditions of approval, even though they had a track record of what they've done in the past, even though they had a similar facility in Santa Monica with rave reviews. Ultimately, it got appealed. I was one of the planning commissioners that was supporting it right off the bat. Went back and forth, council chambers was filled up. Basically, we gave them the entitlements and it got appealed, then it went to the council. And fortunately, the council decided to give them the entitlements that they wanted. Fast forward, now, you know, most of the people in the West Washington area love Upward Bound House. It's great. It's a fantastic, fantastic organization of what they do as far as transitional housing. Another experience I have, one of the last matters that I dealt with on the Planning Commission was Tilden Terrace. That was one of the last projects, redevelopment agency projects, where there was public-private partnership to create affordable housing. There were some people that did not want that either. Why? It shouldn't be there. It's too close. It's down the street. So we as a community, I'd like, you know, regardless of how this election plays out, I'd like us to kind of think a little bit. When we talk about these real important issues, we have a significant community discussion. Are you willing to have it down the street from your house? And I hope most people say, yes, they are. And then we can move on. If people are saying, no, we aren't, This is academic. We're just talking in circles. Rent control. I'm against rent control. I'll leave it simple as that. And the reason I'm against rent control is because I think it artificially impacts this market. The market is tenuous as it is. You start messing around with it, then ultimately what can occur is that rents go up higher than what they are now. There's unintended consequences. Thank you.
Albert Vera.
I think housing definitely is an issue, but quite frankly, we don't have the land right now to put housing, so what do? We have to really, I think, give incentives to developers to build property where we have quite a good number of affordable housing units in it. You know, what do we give them? Maybe they give us open park spaces, money for the TOD district, something that we need to really incentivize developers to do. Another thing with the general plan coming up, I think it's really imperative that we take a look at it. It's sort of the blueprint for the entire city. Take a look and see what areas we need density. We definitely need them around the TOD area where we can live, work, and hop on the metro, hop on the train, and get to where we're going. But I think what we need to do is, in the general plan, create areas where you can rezone a specific property, a land, a normal-sized lot, create sort of like micro-housing. You can take a normal-sized lot, which is going for about $1 million these days in Culver City, you split that into four, you automatically have $250,000 lot. It becomes a lot more reasonable, a lot more equitable for families to buy or to rent or to live in Culver City. And we can also provide incentives for development to supply housing to our first responders, our fire, our police, and give them some type of cutback on taxes or whatever it would be to just really provide more housing for our local workers.
Daniel Lee.
I think rent control has been used as sort of a political cudgel that has really prevented any substantive talk around affordable housing for quite some time, not just in Culver City, but throughout Los Angeles County. I think I've been talking more about what I see as renter protections that provide a little more flexibility for our seniors who should have the opportunity to age in place, and many of them have been renters in Culver City for 20 or 30 years, and for young people who actually want to live and work near their families. I think, for instance, a lot of the places that have rent control currently are experiencing the same housing crisis that we're experiencing now. There are usually caps on rent that are 3 to 10% per year, but renting affordability is still non-existent in those areas as well. So I would talk more about a renter's bill of rights, a renter's protections. For instance, if you get your rent raised by 10%, you know, having 30 days or 60 days to be able to make up that difference is reasonable. But if your rent is raised by 300%, 60 days is often not enough time for someone to see if they can actually take on this extra burden. So I would invite us to throw away the term rent control and think about a third option, an option that would provide the capacity for people to remain a part of their community without going broke and would allow landlords to still make a profit. I think that's possible. I think when we say rent control, things get incredibly polarized and people think, oh, either these people are gonna win or these people are gonna win. That's not the case. It's basic negotiation. When it comes to affordable housing, I think obviously inclusionary zoning is where we should go. And the thing that we need to reckon with in Culver City in general is density. It's another thing that we need to reckon with when it comes to Los Angeles County in general. But the density question begs the question, are we gonna build dense luxury units that are exclusively luxury, or are we gonna build dense units that people who are middle class or lower class can actually afford? And that's another question that we need to reckon with. Obviously, we need workforce housing. I think one of the ways that a community becomes more cohesive is if our staff, our teachers, our garbage men and women, and particularly our police officers can afford to live within the community. I think it encourages community cohesiveness, and it makes it so if there is some type of argument or if there is some type of unfortunate accident, our police officers are more likely to actually know the people involved and be connected and know the day-to-day issues that they're dealing with and not make an assumption that can often lead down a dark road. I think in general, we need to be more active in terms of addressing the issue of affordable housing. And I think there's a lot of potential for people who are advocates of affordable housing and developers who want to build more affordable housing to work together to make more mixed use, mixed income developments in Culver City and beyond.
Thank you. The next question goes to Marcus Tiggs. This past year, the chamber advocated for the city to come up with a way to recycle expanded polypropylene, aka styrofoam. Instead, council members opted for a feel-good ban of restaurants using foam-to-go containers. What steps should the city take regarding sustainability?
As far as sustainability, I think that the city would be well served when we look at, you know, the sustainability issues, that we are able to not only just ban items like the styrofoam, but to also recycle it. Because in recycling it, it's possibly an income generator for the city. And just banning something doesn't necessarily become an income generator for the city. So I think it would behoove the city to talk to experts in the area, look at what other cities are doing to generate income from styrofoam in this instance.
Albert Bureau.
Thank you. I think we really need to be cautious in terms of businesses and all. As a business owner, when it came with the banning of polystyrene, I was really one of the first to comply with these. And I know the expense, the cost of it can be expensive, especially to some smaller mom and pop sort of organizations. I definitely believe that the ban is a good thing. It's bad for our environment. But like Mark said, we need to really look into recycling as well. You know, we have, you say you buy a TV from Best Buy, it's packed in styrofoam. What do we do with that styrofoam? We throw it in the garbage can. No, let's try to figure out a way where we can get it and really recycle it and make the most of it and be as proactive as we can, but also in protecting the businesses.
Daniel Lee.
Okay, so I profoundly disagree with the assumption and the question. Recycling polystyrene is both impractical and both financially and physically. So I completely agree with the polystyrene ban. I think we could have gone further. I think the city did a really good job of providing reasonable alternatives that were similarly priced. And if you've handled polystyrene over a number of days, or if you've walked by on a creek, you know it breaks up very easily, and those little pieces go everywhere. And once it's in pieces, it's more or less impossible to recycle. So I actually think the city did a very reasonable thing, and they took a little too much time doing a very reasonable, obvious thing. So I completely disagree with the premise. I think it was very good that we banned single-use polystyrene in Culver City, and I think we should have done it sooner.
But why not recycle if you've got cities like the city of Torrance that are already recycling polystyrene?
I think we could do an audit of the city of Torrance and see the amount of revenue that they get from it versus the amount of manpower that they put in it. And I think your results would basically make my case for it. And I think that I answered that with my first statement, that it's both financially and physically impractical.
one of my client agencies is CalRecycle, and the limits of recycling are going to start becoming apparent very soon. I think it's safe and public to say. You know, PET and HPDE, the number one and two plastic, highly recyclable and highly recovered. Pretty good programs there. As you move down the chart, the recycling, the recovery rates go way, way down. The amount of energy required to recycle goes way, way up, and there's really not a sustainable future. The expanded polystyrene is really problematic in the environment. It's not a pretty future if we don't start to move away from the more problematic and really all single-use plastic products. This is a long-term objective, and obviously Culver City is just a tiny 5-square-mile city, but you know, where there are opportunities, where there's a movement happening, where we can apply pressure at the state level, I'm not opposed. And I know that this is the wrong forum to say that, but I think it's important that we take stewardship of our planet very seriously. And I think it's absolutely in every business owner's interest to do that too. So while accommodating business interests, I think we need to, and being mindful of the impositions and burdens, we need to move towards a clean and sustainable, healthy planet. It's a big challenge. You know, we need to implement, to address your actual question, we need to look at that low impact development water capture concept, I think. We need to begin to treat our own water on site as much as possible. The future of our water supply is local. As we start to lose the late spring thaw from the Sierra Nevada snowpack, the State Water Resources Control Board's plan is that we use local water. So we need clean local water. So low impact development water, stormwater plans are necessary. We need to consider a networked gray water recycling program in the TOD area where there's a lot of development happening. Obviously, if you pile up everybody's demands on developers up here, you've got a mobility fund, and you've got traffic demand management, and you've got, now I'm talking about recycled water. So we have to prioritize things, but that's one concept that's worth exploring. We need to look into distributed electrical generation from sustainable sources. As solar generation becomes cheaper on site, we need to find ways to produce it and store it locally and distribute it locally. As we join LACE, the local alternative energy program, we should pursue aggressive, sustainable energy mix in our, that we should make sure that we're using renewables without imposing a huge cost burden on the consumer. We're not gonna make our goals if we alienate people by increasing their electric bills. And finally, the general plan is probably the most significant part of this answer, because carbon dioxide emissions, other greenhouse gas emissions, we're gonna have to take serious steps, and it's. I think we have. Very soon, we'll be looking at the realities of what that means. 40% of our greenhouse gas emissions come from transportation, and while there's obviously technological hope on the horizon, we will also need to talk in the general plan about how we can bring down greenhouse gas emissions in our daily lives while greatly improving our public wealth and quality of life.
Thank you. The next question is to Albert Vera. What is your view on split roll property taxes? What is your view on split roll property tax?
Between commercial and split, I'm not really familiar actually with it. I know in terms of split roll with me and property tax, but split roll tax I'm not 100% familiar with. I'm sorry.
Basically splitting the residential and commercial property tax from what's currently equal to differentiate between them.
I'm not really familiar. I'm sorry.
Daniel Lee.
I think in this context, if I understand what you're talking about, to some degree, I am very supportive of Prop 13 reform when it comes to property tax, mostly in the context of making sure that large multinational corporations like Amazon, Microsoft, Apple, and other companies that often transfer property to themselves to avoid a hike in property tax, I'm very supportive of taxing them in a separate and different way to make sure that the general fund of the state gets the revenue that it needs to fund things like education. And I'm very concerned and open to the concerns of residential property owners, a lot of them who are elderly, who are wary of any type of Prop 13 reform, and also small business owners. But I think there is a way for us to look at property tax in a bifurcated way in terms of the annual revenue of the business and the amount of property that they own, and basically come up with tax policy based on those.
Alex Fish.
When it comes to Prop 13, I'm glad I'm only running for city council, where I've got absolutely no authority over it. Because we're seeing the extreme distortions of the Prop 13 regime, and it's really, it's something that I think, another topic that will be consuming the state for quite a while. The split role concept, it sounds good, and I want to accept it. I think I can accept it for golf courses, sorry golfers, but when you're talking about, our job generators, a lot of businesses that are facing, their workers are facing incredibly high housing costs because of other choices we've made. They've got, there's just costs because of choices we've made, especially with housing. They're paying high salaries and still having a hard time retaining workers. Many of you may be experiencing this. I mean, it's just very expensive to live here. If you increase property taxes for some of our businesses, you might actually hit the limit. I would support closing. It should be a no-brainer to close loopholes in Prop 13, where you have corporations tipping over 51% ownership within the corporation, so that there's a change of control, but there's no reassessment. That's a transfer of property between two entities, and it should be treated as such. Not that I have any say-so.
Marcus Tiggs.
Split role property taxes, it's been going around for a while as far as talking about it. There's been some traction. It kind of makes sense when you think about it to bring more revenue to do it this way. But the second and third order effects, when you start potentially raising the property taxes on commercial property owners, it's going to impact, it has a potential of impacting the quality of life for Culver City residents and businesses negatively. And I say it this way, if the property taxes are increased in that commercial building that you're renting or you're leasing, when it's time to renew your lease, guess what? It's going up quite a bit more than what it would have gone up if we didn't have the split roll property taxes and the taxes increase. Third order effect is the business might shut down. I mean, rents are high enough for your business owners. So, I mean, this could be enough to essentially make our downtown, I'm not gonna call it a ghost town, I don't think we're gonna see a ghost town ever again, at least in our lives, but it could make more businesses shutter. I'm not for it. It's a nice idea to give money, but sometimes we need to look at what the environment is actually around. If we do, we can't look at things and just compartmentalize, we need this, we want to get some extra money, and then we get the extra money. We have to also think about what happens when we do that. And when we do that, I think we're gonna lose jobs, there's gonna be less of incentives to certain businesses to move into our city. And it's adverse overall to the businesses and the residents.
Thank you. The next two questions are meant to be more lightning roundish. That should not take a whole lot of explanation. But Daniel Lee, if elected, what would be your number one priority as a council member?
My number one priority, this is unfortunate for the lightning round, but would be the general plan, because it affects our sustainability, our overall development policies, and our vision for the city going forward.
Thank you. Alex Fish.
My number one priority is basically based on the combination of importance and timeliness and my experience, it's to make sure that the Inglewood oil field regulations are strictly protecting public health based on evidence, science, and within the law, and to begin planning for the safe and financially secure retirement of the oil field.
Marcus Takes.
Empowering the neighborhoods, and I say it this way because we do have the general plan update, that is going to be the roadmap of the next 20 or 30 years. The neighborhoods have to be empowered, and to the neighborhoods that are not, have formal neighborhood associations, we need to help them formulate a neighborhood association so they can be involved in the process.
Al Rivera.
Mine would be development and mobility. We really need to think wisely about where we develop, what we develop, and how we're going to get traffic through our city and through those the businesses that we really want. Also, I believe that, for a quick one, that's it. Yeah.
Thank you. Alex Fish, this one is for you. What have you done personally to enhance economic development or the business climate in Culver City?
I think my work on the Committee on Homelessness is ultimately great for business. I work in downtown Los Angeles, and while business is thriving down there, it is, I think, very difficult for business owners who have people on the streets. Culver City, I think our police department our police department has the right values, and they're not forcing people out of town. We're instead engaging with service partners who are connecting people with services, and that's why you don't see a ton of people on the streets.
Marcus Tiggs, same question.
I didn't write it down, but I think I remembered it.
When I was on the Planning Commission, the entitlements for Symantec is a great corporate neighbor. Provides a whole bunch of jobs to our city and provides a significant amount of money to support our general fund.
Albert Barron.
What was the question? I was talking to you. I'm sorry.
What have you done personally to enhance economic development or the business climate in Culver City?
Personally, I mean, as a business owner, I try to really reach out to my local business owner, try to enhance our relationship, try to really stimulate businesses within my own community. And reaching out to the community as well. Personally, as a small business owner, I understand the value and the concept of the community benefit, reaching out to one another and just helping out through local vendors.
Daniel Lee.
I think personally, the most direct impact I've had is I've tried to patronize as many businesses as possible. I've gotten to all of your businesses, but I'll be there. but from a sincere policy perspective, I think I've tried to really push as a community advocate environmental concerns, which I think will set up the city to be a leader and draw in businesses and residents who actually value environmental stewardship and sustainability. And I think that's been a draw for a lot of businesses and a lot of professional workers for quite some time, and I think it will be so into the future.
Thank you, gentlemen. We've come to our closing statements. You guys have all been fantastic. Thank you very much. We will go from Alex to Marcus in this time. So in 90 seconds or less, Alex, your closing remarks.
Thank you all very much for coming out this morning, braving the winds. I'm thrilled to run. It's been a real education in the city. It's some of these questions have evolved just in the process of meeting people, hearing their concerns, and learning more about what you all think. Thank you for that. This is a very exciting time for Culver City. We've got so much change going on that we have some neighborhoods that feel buried in both public and private investment, and there's concerns about losing the sense of place and the community identity. There are other neighborhoods that have been long neglected and are saying, how am I supposed to get to all this great new stuff? I think that my background really, it just so happens that I've thought about the issues that are most pressing for Culver City right now. And I believe that we can take all these challenges and all this investment and all this change, harness it, and advance our public and common good and make this city
an even more wonderful place to live for the next 100 years. Thank you.
Daniel Lee.
So thank you for having us this morning. I will say, I think I do miss the eggs and bacon. but this is a wonderful location, and it's nice to see more of the city with every forum. As I said, my priorities sometimes seem like they're not aligned with the Chamber of Commerce, but I think in general, a city that is environmentally sustainable, where our elected officials are accountable both to our stakeholders and our business owners, and where everyone has their fair shake, is a city where we can all thrive. And I think there are very many ways, as I mentioned last year, that we may disagree about things, but there are very many more ways that we can actively work together. And I think no matter who's on the next city council, and of course I will be on it, I think there are ways to move our city forward in a very forward-looking, sustainable, and really sort of, I don't know, I almost want to say 22nd century way that really combines all of the incredible technological companies that are moving in with our desire for sustainability and our desire to maintain the community that is the reason that we either moved to Culver City or decided to set up a business here.
Al Rivera.
Thank you all for coming. Thank the Chamber for hosting this. In closing, you know, as a businessman, as a local businessman in Culver City, I understand the need for a thriving business community, but I also understand the need for balance. We need to really create balance with the city, with our residents, with our businesses, with the whole commerce all together. Yeah, we definitely need a need for balance. I'm looking forward to bringing my business mind to City Council, and do I know all the answers? No, I don't. Am I eager to learn? Yes, I definitely am. We have a great staff at Culver City. I'm eager to sit down with them and learn all I can about the inner workings of the city and trying to move city forward in the next century. Thank you very much for coming.
Marcus Tiggs.
We live in a great city. We do. We have a vibrant business community. That's you folks here. We have an excellent chamber compared to other chambers. So I'm proud of that. On these forums, we talk about issues like the sky is falling in a way, but we need to look at it. We are fortunate. We are really fortunate. No one's shooting at you. Roads are basically safe. There are no major potholes. The garbage is picked up. All these things are fantastic. I think my qualifications are unique. I say this not because of being on the Planning Commission for 8 years and all the things I've done for the city. I did that not for any stepping stone to try to run for council or anything like that. I did that because I love the city. Regardless of what happens, I'm still going to love the city. I'm still going to do stuff. I like to call this an 80-20 rule. 80% of the stuff we all agree on that relates to our city. It's that 20% that we maybe disagree. Let's start focusing. And if I get elected, I'm going to champion focusing on that 80% thing. What we agree on, it's just a matter of how we get it done. Instead of being mad at each other on the 20% and assuming that 20% is what drives us to be members of this community and being the best ambassadors this community has.
Thank you, gentlemen. I'd like to thank you all for coming this morning. I'd like to thank Scott Bowling and OCF for hosting this lunch. Karen Hansen at Copenhagen Bakery for the food and bath. And this is an important election, so please, those of you who are residents, please do get out and vote.